Today you'll learn how to create realistic product mockups in Photoshop using a simple set of steps that you'll be able to follow even if you're a total beginner. There are a lot of steps that you'll learn here that I've never covered on this channel, so if you have a hard time remembering anything, I created a free lesson cheat sheet that will help make these steps way easier to wrap your head around. More on how to grab your copy of that cheat sheet later in this video, but for now, let's jump into Photoshop. Now, a product mockup at the most basic level is a shape that has been warped around an object that you can then apply your graphics onto so that it automatically fits around that object. Now, to make that graphic actually blend into your photo, you need to have separated highlights and shadows, which is easily done using luminosity masks. Now, we're going to use a variation of those in this video, and that's exactly what we're going to start with. So clicking on the background layer, we're going to start by separating the highlights from this image and placing them on their own layer. To do that, I'll click on the channels panel and then hold command or control and hover over the RGB thumbnail. While holding command or control and clicking on the RGB thumbnail, this will create a selection of the highlights in my photo. Going back to the layers panel and selecting my background layer while this selection is active, I'll press Command or Control J to duplicate that selection area. Now, if I look at this single layer, you can see that we have the highlights separated, which will be important later in the lesson. Double clicking on this layer, I'll call this two highlights. I'll now turn this layer off by clicking the eyeball icon and click on the background layer once again. I'll go back to my channels panel, which if you don't see, by the way, just go up to Window and then down to Channels to locate it. But this time we're going to do the same thing, but then invert our selection to activate the shadows. So holding Command or Control, clicking on the RGB layer thumbnail to create an active selection of the highlights, we'll press Command or Control, Shift, and I to now invert that selection area and therefore select the shadows. Going back to our layers panel, we'll click on the background layer and press Command or Control J to duplicate that. We'll double click on this layer and call it to shadows. For now, I'll click on the eyeball icon of the shadows layer as well to turn that off. Now we're ready to go and add the shape that will be warped around our bottle that will set the area for our graphics. To begin, I'll click on my background layer and then go and create a new set of guides to define the general area of our bottle or whatever product you're using. To create new guides, you'll want to first activate the rulers inside of your workspace by pressing Command or Control R. Next, we'll click and drag out from any of the rulers to create some new guides that will fit along the horizontal and vertical edges of our product. So as you can see here, I've created some horizontal guides to match the top and bottom, and then vertical guides to go along the vertical axis of our bottle. Now we can go and use this area to create a shape that will fit tightly to our object without much brain power. So to create a new shape, we'll go and select the rectangle tool in this case from our toolbar. And from there, I'll set the stroke to transparent and the fill does not really matter. But what does matter is that we go and align our crosshairs to the intersection of those guides. And then we'll click and drag out like so to create a shape that fits within the contents of those guides. Now these guides are no longer helpful to us. So we're going to press Command or Control and the semicolon to hide those from our canvas. Now with this rectangle layer selected, I'm going to change the layer blending mode from normal down here to linear burn. This will allow us to see the highlights and shadows of the bottle through that particular layer. However, we'll be doing more blending than this later in the video. Now with this complete, we need to go and add some warping adjustments so that anything that we apply inside of the contents of this shape will match the same curves and angles that our bottle has. Now you don't want to go and apply this warping adjustment to the shape directly, but instead you want to add these warping adjustments to a smart object so that any other graphic elements you place within that smart object will also be warped in the same way. So to begin, I'll right click on this rectangle layer and change this to a smart object by clicking Convert to Smart Object. Now I'll double click on the name of this layer and call it to Graphic Area. Next, we're ready to go and warp this. So with the graphic area layer selected, I'll press Command or Control T to activate the transform tool. I'll right click within that transform box and go to warp. Now what we want to do is use this grid to warp our adjustment to look as if it's curving around the shape of our object, which in this case is sort of a cylinder shape for the bottle. So the way that we can do this is simply by clicking and dragging on these anchor points here. But since I have a pretty dramatic change in direction within the bottle, I'll click on the horizontal split option in the options bar, and then go and add a new horizontal split right where the direction of that bottle changes. With that complete, I'll now click on these top anchor points, and it will just help me to lock that particular area into place and allow me to get a cleaner result with the final warp. So we're going to continue to move this over. We can use our anchor points to adjust this grid to look as if it's warping around our bottle. This might take you a little bit of practice and fine tuning to get the hang of, but the main goal here is that your vertical lines look totally straight, and then all of the horizontal lines are going to match the curve of that particular object. So go ahead and take a few moments to warp your particular shape to your object. Once you're happy with your warping adjustments, you can look at the grids within your shape layer, and they should match the contours of your object. So in this case, I just have that slight curve to represent the cylinder shape of our object. Now with this complete, we'll press the check mark to save those changes. Now really quickly, if you're enjoying the tutorial so far, make sure to let me know by hitting that like button down below. Anyways, let's get back to it. Now we have a shape that is warped to the area of our object, but to make it so that this shape is only visible within the contents of our object, we need to use a selection. Now I've already gone ahead and used the pen tool to create a selection around the edges of this object, so I'm just gonna go ahead and load that into my project. However, if you haven't created a selection already, you'll need to take a moment to do that now. If you don't know how to use any selection methods inside of Photoshop, you can learn the best ones for beginners right here if you're interested. But anyways, like I said, I'm going to load in that selection by going to Select, Load Selection, and then go and choose my bottle selection. I'll now click OK to create an active selection. With this active selection, I'll click on my graphic area layer and add a layer mask so that now that graphic area layer is only visible on my bottle like so. With this complete, we're now ready to go and add our graphics onto this bottle. And to do that, we just need to access the contents of our smart object layer. To access those contents, simply double click on the thumbnail of that smart object layer. So double clicking there will open up a new project window here containing all of the contents of that smart object layer. So this is where you're going to go and add any of the graphics that you want to appear on your product. In this case, I already have a graphic that I want to bring into this project here. So I've just copied and pasted it over into my smart object contents. Once you've added your images that you would like for your final mockup, you can also do things like adding patterns as well. I'm going to go ahead and create a new pattern layer directly above my rectangle layer. To do that, I'll click on the adjustments icon and go up here to pattern to create a new pattern fill layer. In the pattern fill window, I'll go ahead and choose one of my pattern ribbon options, which I downloaded for free. And if you want to grab a copy of them for yourself, I'll leave a link down below so you can use these as well. But I'm going to go ahead and use this pattern right here. I'll then go to the scale and increase the scale of this pattern so that it's a little bit more dramatic. I'll then click OK. From here, we can go and change the background color of our rectangle layer by clicking on the fill option and then going and setting the color to red, for example. Once you're happy with your changes, and remember, whatever you see here is going to be the design that is applied onto your object. But once you're happy, just press Command or Control S to save your smart object contents. That way, when we go back to our mockup project, you can see that our bottle now contains the graphics that we have placed inside of our smart object layer. Now at this point, things are looking decent, but they aren't really blended well into our photo. And that's where our shadows and highlight layers are going to come into play. So I'll click on the eyeball icon to re-enable those. Now the problem with these layers currently is that they're affecting the entire photo. So I only want them to affect the areas that our graphics are affecting. The easiest way to fix this is simply by duplicating our graphic area layer mask to our shadow and highlight layers. To quickly duplicate this layer mask, hold Alt or Option and click on that layer mask while holding Alt or Option, then click and drag up and let go on the desired layer you want to duplicate it to. Again, hold Alt or Option, click and drag up and let go once again. So now we have a matching layer mask for all of our layers. From there, I'll click on my highlights layer and set the layer blending mode from normal down here to overlay. Then for the shadows layer, I'll change the layer blending mode from normal down here to multiply. And this way we have a much nicer result where the contrast of our original object blends in a little bit better. But we can increase the intensity of the highlights or the shadows using a curves adjustment layer. For example, let's say I want to make these shadows a little bit more intense. By clicking on the shadows layer, I can go up to my adjustments panel and create a new curves adjustment layer. Clicking on the clipping mask icon so that this curves adjustment only affects my shadows layer, I can now click on this black point here since we're adjusting the shadows, and I'll drag this over to increase the intensity of those shadows as you see here. The same thing could be done for your highlights as well, except you would just be adjusting the highlights point instead. So now with our highlights blended in, we can go and refine the look of our mockup in a few different ways. Of course, if we ever wanted to go back and change what actually appears on our product, all we need to do is double click on this smart object layer to re-access the smart object contents where we can go and add any graphics, patterns, colors, whatever we want. We can do it all inside of the smart object. But just remember, once you're finished here, press Command or Control S to save your changes back into your original project like so. From here, if you wanted to go and refine your product so that the visible graphic is only in parts of your product and not the entire thing, all you need to do is go and adjust the graphic area layer mask. For example, I want to go and reveal the white of the original product down at the bottom of this bottle, right along the crease here. By creating a selection with the pen tool, for example, you can easily isolate this area. I've already gone ahead and done this, so I'll just go up to Select, Load Selection, and then go down to my bottom selection and click OK. With this active selection area that I again created previously with my pen tool, I'll just click on the Color Fill option within the contextual taskbar while the graphic area layer mask is selected, and I'll choose black. This will now fill that layer mask with transparency in that selected area. I'll press Command or Control D to deselect that. Now, the final way that we can customize our mockup is changing the background color. And the easiest way to do that is using a color fill layer. Clicking on our background layer, I'll click on the adjustments icon and go up here to solid color to create a new color fill layer. For now, I'll go and choose a red color like so and click OK. Next, we'll change the layer blending mode of that color fill layer down here to multiply because we have a white background. This will apply that color into the white, but it will still reveal those shadows within our original image. Now, of course, we don't want this color to overtake our actual product. So what we can do to refine this is simply duplicate the highlights or shadows layer mask. I'll hold Alter option and then click and drag down from my highlights layer mask and let go over the color fill layer. Since it's the opposite of what we want, I'll click on that color fill layer mask and press Command or Control I to invert it. Now it will only be affecting the background. But in this case, I didn't actually have a selection of the bottle cap. So I'll click on my background layer, choose Select Subject, and then with this active selection, I'll click back on the color fill layer mask, grab my brush tool by pressing B, and with my foreground color set to black, I'll just go and paint over this bottle cap to remove the visible areas of the background color over our product. Now with the bottle cap restored, I'll press Command or Control D to deselect that. And from here, we can simply double click on that color fill layer thumbnail to change the color of this background as we would wish to anything else that you want, depending on the style of your particular project. So now with that complete, you now have a finished mockup project that you know how to customize to your taste, and you can use this at any time in the future. Now, like I mentioned at the beginning of this video, if you want to grab your free lesson cheat sheet covering all of the steps that you learned here, just click the link down in the description below. Just type in your name and email so I know where to send it, and a brand new PDF will instantly appear in your inbox. You'll also be signed up to get all of my future cheat sheets for upcoming tutorials, so by signing up once, you get all the ones in the future as well. Anyways, that is all for this video, and I'll catch you back here next time.